Good morning. This is Melissa Hales Spencer, the editor at the Altamont Enterprise, and I'm really excited to have across the table from me Laura Shore. Welcome, Laura.
Thank you. Good morning.
We have so many different things to talk about because it seems to me Laura is one of those people, when she is part of a community, she throws herself into all different aspects of that community. I first met Laura about 12 years ago doing a home and garden story because she and Nancy Oda have this beautiful house that they have restored, the Jacob Crounse Inn. And from there, her name just kept popping up in many, many places. So I'd like to start with just talking a little bit about how you came to Altamont and how and why you got so invested in so many aspects of the community here.
Well, we were living in Albany and we had decided to move out into the country-ish. And I had been doing a lot of genealogy research. Actually, I would get interested in things and then follow up leads. And I really wasn't even researching my own family. I was like researching random people for fun. And Nancy saw the ad for the Inn of Jacob Crounse in the paper. And she said, "Wow, that's an old country inn. You could research everybody that ever lived there." And so sort of on a lark, we drove out and took a look, and it seemed like just a very, very interesting project. And we didn't have the faintest idea what we were getting into, and it took a big chunk out of our savings. But it's been kind of a labor of love. And unfortunately, I never found a register, so I couldn't research all the people that lived there, but I could imagine who might have stayed there. And once, you know, when you buy one of the big houses in a town, people reach out to you to do things. And so I was asked to put the house on the act, Altamont Community Tradition house tour, the Victorian holidays. And after a lot of hemming and hawing, I finally decided to do it. And then, got asked to be, you know, part of the group. And I have a really hard time saying no to things. So that's really why my name keeps coming up.
And she's now the president of that group. She's just a girl who can't say no. So tell us a little, for people that don't know, what Altamont Community Tradition is.
Sure. Altamont Community Tradition was started, I think about 2002, and I think it was started as a kind of in reaction to the losses of some of the Victorian houses, the older homes in the village. And it was probably more activist in its early days. Mm-hmm. And over time, it's really become a group that doesn't take a position on village issues, but tries to create memories, tries to create a sense of community in the village. We're a pretty small group. It's a small village, so there's a limited number of people who have a lot of time to devote to volunteer activities. But we sponsor the Strawberry Social in the spring, which is kind of a kickoff.
And just that name.
I know.
Elizabeth does the back in time and is always coming across socials. And just to come up with that is a modern idea. Mm-hmm. Is so wonderful.
And it's lovely. I mean, people, the Linen Dolls, do these wonderful kids' games in the park.
With the giant parachute.
And we get volunteers from all over. And it's an incredible... I don't know. It seems like every year there's a thunderstorm early in the day and then the sky clears up and it's beautifully crystal clear evening and there are kids running around and jumping.
And another remarkable thing is, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's strawberry shortcake, and it's handmade shortcake, right?
Right.
I mean, people bake this themselves, which also doesn't happen these days.
No, it doesn't. We get together, so the, you know, there are a few people who get together. We get the strawberries from Altamont Orchards. They always, it's always a question, are there going to be strawberries this year? And but they always seem to come through, and people get together and cut up quarts and quarts and quarts of strawberries. And then another group of people gets together and bakes 350 strawberry shortcakes. And Stewart's donates whipped cream, and it just sort of comes together pretty.
And then around the holidays, you have the Victorian holiday.
Right, right. And that's really where the group spends most of its time and energy. We'll be starting up organizing it at the next meeting, which is September 5th. And anybody's welcome to volunteer for the board. We have meetings on the first Thursday of every month at the Masonic Hall. It's a really great group of people, very diverse. We have different ways to participate. There's the board, who get to vote on things, and then there's Friends of ACT, who are sort of a community of ready volunteers who also are invited to the meeting. So it's actually become a lot of fun. The Victorian holidays is usually the second Sunday in December. And did I say Sunday? I think it's Saturday.
I think it's Saturday.
I think it's Saturday. Yeah. And so we have usually have house tours. They've been over the years. They've taken a couple of years off from house tours. We're starting to run out of houses, and so that's always.
But you can always
every
year. Revisit them because they're new people.
They have new owners and new houses, and so again, if people want to have their houses on the tour, they should contact us, because it's always a bit of a challenge finding people that are willing to have, you know, 150, 200 people tromp through their house.
And it's so nice because the businesses are open. We always look forward to it because we get to meet hundreds of our readers and we take their portraits. And it's just, it feels like, you know, you're inviting people into your home. It just has a nice ambiance to it.
It's great. I just love it. I love seeing the streets come alive with people walking, you know, up and down the streets. We started a few years ago, we started something we call the Winter Market, where we invite vendors to participate, either in the, you know, there are people in the Orsini Park, you know, the Boy Scouts sell these little cute little reindeer made out of birch logs, and there's, you know, people with candied apples and cider and whatnot. And then the restaurants are open. Agway donates trees. There's a tree decorating contest where different businesses and organizations will, you know, come together and decorate a tree, and the enterprise should do a tree. That would be fun, wouldn't it? I'm inviting you here on the air.
But I'm not going to accept on the air.
Okay.
Who knows what might happen? But I think, how would we decorate a tree? Newspapers?
Well, you've got a little bit of time. Anyway, so it's really every year we think, oh my God, it's so much work. But then when it actually happens, it's really, really
It does.
Wonderful.
It feels magical.
And
it
Santa,
really does.
I mean, how many villages have a Victorian train station that Santa can arrive at?
And the kids are screaming.
Yes,
and the excitement is palpable.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, it's magical.
Yeah.
Well, so now you're up to something new. You emailed that there's going to be the first Founders Day, and you are helping to volunteer for that. So I know you said that Dan Barker is in charge as the... What is it, archivist? Is that
he's the director of the archives?
The director of the archives. Hard shoes to fill there, Mary Jo's. But tell us what Founders Day is going to be.
Well, Dan started a little while ago, and he's a librarian in Albany, and he's lives in the village and grew up here, and he's sort of getting his bearings, and there are some of us who have been volunteering over the last few years. So Keith Lee and Connie Rue and Judy Deneen, Lois Ginsburg. And so we kind of got together and we were thinking, what should we do? And October seemed like a really far away. And we said, oh, well, let's celebrate Altamont's Founders Day, which is October 18th. And what we did was we decided to back it up to Columbus Day weekend, because there's a New York State tourism project called Path Through History. Mm-hmm. And what they do is they have a, and you, people can go to, I think it's paththroughhistory.org, but you can also Google it. They have a website where all the different communities can post their history-related activities. So if you're a history buff or just somebody looking for something fun to do on the weekend, you can go there and you can find all these different destinations. And then twice a year, in May and October, they have like a weekend where people tend to host events, and so you can go to different events. So in May, the Gilderland Historical Society did one with Path Through History, and different groups had participated. They put you on a map, and then, you know, people come. So we thought it would be a really nice opportunity to publicize Museum in the Streets and also to sort of kick off a new round of archives activities, because it's been kind of quiet since Mary Jo passed. And so what we decided to do was to look at the founders, and we thought, oh, how hard can that be, right? I mean, they're really important. We'll find their photos and write up little bios. And it's actually turned out to be harder than we thought. But
didn't Alice Begley mount a project where every single mayor of Altamont is framed?
The mayors are all there, so, in the hallway.
But you're looking for other founders.
So we thought we would start with the people that were on the plaque, you know, by Orsini Park. Mm-hmm. And then we said, well, geez, you know, Lucie Cassidy is so important in that time period. She's practically a founder. So let's add her to the mix. And so we've just been kind of working away, going through the archives, and as we're doing it, we're sort of making a list of all the things we need to do to make it easier to find stuff in the future.
So. And you've done a remarkable amount of research on Lucie Cassidy, and here's a teaser. Some of this will be running as a letter to the editor closer to Founders Day, but just tell us some of the amazing facts about the whole Cassidy family.
Sure. You know, it's like we all know about Lucie Cassidy because of St. Lucie's Church. She bought the land and kind of connected, I guess, with the Albany Diocese. The story goes that she needed a place for her maids to worship on Sundays. She had built a home on the hill with the other summer mansions about 1885.
Is that still standing? Is her?
You know, there's some question about which of the houses up there is her house.
Okay.
I'm not exactly sure. I think it might be over there on Presentation Way, but it's owned by the diocese, and so I haven't been able to get over there yet. Keith is sort of the one who has the bead on all the different houses. Mm-hmm. What I was looking for was a photo, and I found a mention that there's a very grainy newspaper photo from the Times Union, and it said this is the only existing photo of Lucie Cassidy. And I thought, well, that can't possibly be true. I mean, how could somebody be so prominent and not have a photograph? And so I went through the archives, couldn't find anything, went to the State Museum, called the Albany Institute of History and Art. So then I thought, okay, well, she has to have descendants. So I went to Ancestry.com and started researching her. And what I discovered was this incredible family story where she was married to William Cassidy, who was a prominent newspaper man
in the Albany Argus.
Albany Argus, right? In the early, kind of early 1800s, mid 1800s. And he actually made his money through his connection with Boss Tweed. And I, that
not just, a very honorable,
not a very honorable
man, no.
connection. And it was so, I don't know a lot about 19th century political New York history, but the more I learned, it was just really astonishing. It kind of reminds me of today. But so Boss Tweed was trying to kind of take over the Albany state politics the way he had taken over New York City politics. And he bought off the newspaper. So the Argus, he paid for what they call state printing. So the state, one of the newspapers would publish state bills, and they got paid a reasonable amount of money to do that. Well, William Cassidy's, the Argus's payments went from $5,000 to like $175,000 in a time period of over about 6 or 7 years. So, you know, most of that money went into his pockets. Mm-hmm. And so he then was disinclined to criticize Boss Tweed. So he died fairly conveniently, and Lucy inherited all of his money. And her most colorful son was Edward, who married a Belgian countess and ultimately divorced her. But while he was married, he was given a large sum of money by his mother, which he then spent, it seems, almost entirely over a short amount of time on what came to be known as Cassidy Castle, which was another estate up on the hill. And he wanted to be an artist. And so he traveled back and forth to France and ultimately settled in France. And then the enterprise covered him, covered all of them pretty closely. But the most interesting thing, I think, was in World War II, Edward and his second wife were living behind enemy lines in France. Edward had gotten too old to travel home, and so she stayed there and took care of him. And her son, their son, was in the army, and when the U.S. Invasion of Italy happened, he got leave to go up to France and track down his mother. His father had died by then, and he was able to find his mother in a little village in Brittany. And it just seems like a movie, you could just see.
Yeah, well, her, and the way you describe it, yeah, in this letter, too, you seem to have a biographer's mind. And another thing I just wanted to have you talk a bit about is the wonderful biography you did of Ev Rau. Just tell us a bit about how you got into that and why you did it.
Well, it was Ev. So it was another archives project. I was working with Mary Jo, and she was doing something on, it was either the, I think it was the fair, and I'm really interested in farming and local farming. And I said, well, if you're going to do that, you really need to do something about farming, because it's important and nobody ever talks about it these days. And she said, well, if you're interested in farming, have you met Ev Rau? And so then she introduced me to Ev, and he and I connected like almost immediately. He's just, I couldn't believe he was in his 90s and he was as articulate and just whip smart as he was. And so we became friendly, and he had clearly always had a book in his mind for years. He wanted to tell his story. And he asked me, he said, have you ever written a book? And I said, no. And he said, well, you want to write mine?
And and you actually said yes.
And I thought a minute, and I said, well, how hard can this be? First of all, he's going to lose interest. I mean, nobody has the patience to sit through, all the interviews. But he just, he had these stories in mind. So I would, he and I would talk. I would record what he was saying. I'd go home and research what he talked about, and then I would write it up. He would go through it, correct all the technical things, because I didn't really understand a lot about Dutch barn construction and all the things that he was interested in. But what was fun was that I did a lot of research in the newspapers, and I was able to find things about his father that he didn't know, because he had a terrible relationship with his father, and they really never talked. And
what's remarkable about the book is he was, in everyone's mind, this kind of iconic farmer. And the way you wrote the book, you showed, not in any way that was nasty, it was wonderful, but that was almost a construct.
Mm-hmm.
And that really there were some things in his life that were very, very difficult and very different than the way he kind of presented himself to the world. But it was all done in a very kindly way, and it just is a remarkable book.
Well, thank you. I think he really wanted to tell that story. He had a real sense of redemption, sort of having, you know, been very bitter about his childhood and then coming through it. But I felt like there was another story there. I was really curious about... So his father was very abusive when Ev was young, both to Ev and to his mom. And but I was curious about how his father came to be the person he was. I mean, he was a boogeyman in Ev's world, and I thought, well, what's his story? And so that was my contribution to the book. And I think what that did was it kind of opened up the question, and it you could see the sort of a tortured creative person being sort of, you know, stuck
strapped
on a farm, you know, like in a tiny little town.
He wanted to be an artist.
Right, exactly. Yeah. He'd been living in New York City, you know, work, you know, following his passion. And next thing you know, he's, you know, growing hogs and you know, driving a tractor. And it just made him very bitter. And, you know, so it was a really interesting story.
So someone who's passionate about art is a good segue into yourself as an artist. I think I remember you studied art at Union College, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
And tell us about yourself as an artist. I know we've had in our library columns recently, Sandra Kisselbeck being very enthused about your the way she describes your artwork, and I haven't seen it. I'm so glad you brought some samples, and maybe when Elizabeth takes your picture, we can include some of those so people will see them. But the way Sandra describes them is they're just so vibrant that I think of it, you know, the way flowers were painted by, and now the name is escaping me. Oh, dear. Anyway, let's hear about you as an artist.
So I always wanted to be an artist, even before I knew what that meant. And I...
Tell us a little about that. Like, is it a child?
Yeah. I mean, I just really was interested in looking at things, and I thought...
And did you said you had like a military family upbringing,
We weren't really exposed. I didn't go to an art museum until I was probably 18, 19.
So it's just in
It was just there, and it didn't make any sense, but it just was something that I really wanted to do. But it's not something that, unless you are Edward Cassidy and have a family trust fund, that you can just kind of do. So I studied art, and I was interested in lots of other things, and I ended up working in communications for many, many years. And it was such an absorbing job that I really didn't have a lot of bandwidth left to do anything else. And so, but I had always wanted to retire early and just do art and other things, which is what I did. So when I stopped working, I had been working in, you know, marketing, and I felt like I'm not an art for art's sake kind of person. I had worked with a lot of great designers, and I have always looked at a lot of art and thought a lot about art, and I traveled a lot, and you know, I go to museums the way other people go to baseball parks. You know, it's like I check them off my list. And
do you have a favorite museum?
probably, I have lot. No, it's too hard a question. Among there are lots of favorites? Museums that I love. Yeah. I love the Metropolitan Museum of Art because it's one that I know very well, and I can go and just look at a few things and leave. I love small museums like the Phillips Collection in Washington, D.C., and the Courtauld in London, because, you know, you can go to them and you can really just sort of sit, and there's some really great art there. And I hate museums like the Museum of Modern Art. It's like a bus station that happens to have a lot of paintings. It's just, they're redoing it, so we'll see.
So the physical building matters to you.
It matters a lot, yeah. And big museums and blockbuster shows, I'm just sorry that has become the way of the world, because there's some fantastic collections that have just become so commercialized, you know. And you know, the last time I went to Paris, we were going to visit the Louvre, and the lines were so long that it was like going to Disney World. You know, you just couldn't get in unless you were part of a tour, and then you wouldn't have been able to just go at your own pace. We went to Giverny and got there, I don't know, it was probably about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and the line was like, it was like a 3-hour wait. By the time we got in, it would have been closed. So I love museums. I like looking, like if I go to a big museum, I'll go to the parts of the museum that nobody ever goes to just because it's quiet and I always see something interesting.
So tell us about your own art. What medium do you use?
So I when I started painting after I retired, I was craving color, and I quickly ended up with oil paints, which I had never painted much and wasn't, but it just came very easily to me. And I love painting beautiful things that make people smile. And I love color, and I know a lot about color theory. And so it's one of the reasons when you look at the paintings that they seem to just kind of leap off.
That's what Sandra wrote. They pop right off the canvas.
Yeah.
So do you have certain subjects that you prefer or that you gravitate towards?
I started with a mission, and the mission was to paint local food from local farms. And the idea was that if I could paint enough of them and they looked good enough, I could create shows around it, which would create a conversation about eating local and the importance of supporting local businesses. And, you know, there's a zillion reasons why eating local is a good thing to do.
So this is art with a mission.
It's art with a mission. and it really has a purpose. And I donate 10% of what I sell to Mohawk Hudson Land Conservancy and the Agricultural Stewardship Association. And I try to, I really believe that we're at a critical point, you know, in our world. So painting these small paintings of fruits and vegetables, they're relatively inexpensive. And I also make cards and prints so that more people can have them, because, you know, people can't afford to pay for art on their walls. But I learned I taught myself how to print giclée prints so that I can sell those for $20, $30, and anybody can own them.
Now, what kind of a print is that? I'm not familiar. Giclée?
Okay, it's called giclée, and what that means is it's kind of a made-up word, but they're archival prints made with hot, super high-quality inkjet printers. So the color is just beautiful, and the surface is really beautiful. And if you use good paper, and I have a really nice printer, and the images are just great. Sometimes I like them better than the originals because
could
I tweak them.
Could you hold one up? I just want to see one. Is that what you've got to
Well,
print
no,
in?
these are just postcards.
Oh, so they also come in postcard form.
Well, yeah. I mean, I get those made just to promote them, but yeah. So So I do paintings of fruits and vegetables. And then that starts to get, you know, that got a little, you know, after a while, like, how many can you do? So so I've the last year I've been painting a lot of landscapes and more florals. So it's been, it's just, you know, just paint what I feel like painting. I don't have to make anybody happy but myself. So,
well, it just sounds like you have a marvelous life. Do you have any closing thoughts for our listeners?
Not really. I guess what I feel very strongly about is that Altamont is a jewel of a village, and we have a wonderful opportunity. People have an incredible opportunity in a smallish town to make a difference and to make life better. And I feel like we sometimes forget that. And it doesn't take a lot of time out of your day to volunteer and get involved in things. But people will, you know, the village will remember you, you know, especially through the enterprise. I look back at people who, you know, 100 years ago decided to, you know, Founders Day, they started something. They didn't have to do that. They could have been doing other things. And I think that's, I guess, what I'd like to leave people with.
Well, you have, just by your life. You're an exemplar of that. Thank you so much, Laura Shore.